Hello class, as we all know, college has many new opportunities and experiences among us. Some of it we were prepared for, and some of it we weren't. As you could tell by all the medications over there, I was not prepared for my health. It's a place here filled with new sicknesses, diseases, and terrible air quality, especially since I'm on the third floor hall. And yeah, I was never prepared. I never knew what polyplague was until I felt it firsthand. And it spreads throughout the campus. Some people attempt to circumvent this with non-prescribed medicine. Danger to that, I found out, is people do that without understanding the risks and side effects of them. So, my argument today is to argue that, yes, you can go to the health center, yes, you can go to Rite Aid, get medications, get prepared for any sicknesses that come around, but always do it in moderation. Now, to start off, we all know that procrastination is a thing that we all do. From Emily's example, it's either a bad habit or, in some cases, it can inspire you to work harder and eventually do better. Sometimes it would even go to the point of all-nighters. Now, after all said and done, you might be tired, but you can't sleep, so you take a melatonin pill, a melatonin supplement. Melatonin is a natural hormone in your body. Now, if you go outside, you get your intake of melatonin through daylight. But as most college students do, they stay inside to do their homework. And this, in turn, reduces the melatonin in your system. So increasing the dosage above 10 milligrams, which is 4 or more supplements over there, can actually pose a real threat. According to a men's health issue titled Melatonin Warning, a man had used up to 24 milligrams of melatonin alongside some sedatives. In turn, he ended up waking up to being very lethargic and having memory loss. Unfortunately, sleeping disorders are also an issue. As stated in Philip Waters' article, Natural Alternative Offers Hope on Sleep Disorders from Nursing Standard, melatonin in reasonable amounts helps readjust this circadian rhythm, aka sleeping cycle. This can be found in the health center for around $6, 50 supplements, and you don't have to take it every single day, just when you feel is necessary. Moving on to ibuprofen, it's a substance that is commonly used to alleviate headaches, pain, etc. Even as a non-steroid, the dangers of it can eventually lead to meningitis, aka brain stroke. According to Matthew Smetana's, an acute ibuprofen overdose masking a severe staphylococcus aureus meningitis, in case of course in emergency medicine, acute bacterial meningitis may occur alongside symptoms of having a stiff neck, fevers, and also mental issues. Now, in terms of general side effects, would be nausea, diarrhea, and constipation. Albeit these problems do persist, it is shown in Gerald Petrovsky's article, Use of Low Level of Continuous Heat and Ibuprofen as an Adjunct to Physical Therapy in 2017, ibuprofen can drastically improve ibuprofen can drastically decrease the chronic pain more so than placebo effects. These only cost around $2 at the health center. Next on the list is Dayquil and NyQuil. Both provide the benefit of relieving sore throats, congestion, and coughs. Both also contain acetaminophen. Now, acetaminophen is a pain reliever that could potentially harm the liver. I experienced that the hard way as I was leaving, the day I was sent out. I had to sit down because my liver was feeling very disrupted for a few minutes. According to an article from Clinical Toxicology titled Treating Acetaminophen Overdose in 2013, acetaminophen has now lowered their dosage of 200 milligrams down to 100 milligrams that are supposed to have in your system within 4 hours because of how dangerous it is. This is due to increases of hepatotoxicity, transplants, and also fulminant hepatic failure, all of which deal with liver failure. And for liver failure, some of the symptoms of this would be nausea, fatigue, and diarrhea. In Syed Ziod's article on an analysis of the length of hospital stay after acetaminophen overdose, if taken to a hospital, you are almost guaranteed to have a longer stay there than a short stay. Despite this, its effectiveness in driving away colds still works as long as it's still in the right dosage. The cost of this each should be under $10. So, over the years, people, especially college students, have become more reliant on doing self-medication. Self-medication being taking prescribed medicine whenever they feel is fit. However, the overuse of it has actually become more detrimental to the point of academic dishonesty become more prevalent. Andrew Belushi's article on exploring the relationship between the misuse of stimulant medications and academic dishonesty among a sample of college students in 2016 states that college students from ages 18 to 25 have done 60% more academic dishonesty, like cheating on papers, copying homework, than last year, if they had been using prescriptions more often. Another study, this time from Nadia Khalid's self-medication practice among non-medical university students of Karachi, 2017, shows that 50% of a sample of 400 students have used painkillers more often. As non-prescribed medicine becomes more available to the public, its dependency increases as well. Since college students are more likely to take medications, it has become more of a social norm than a necessity to even take them. As shown in Nicole Schultz's version of prescription stimulants among college students in 2016, there is more perceived approval to use prescriptions for educational use, more so than if you were sick. Medications are used less often to treat a physical problem and are used more for studies. Michael Stasio's over-the-counter medication and herbal or dietary supplement use in college in 2008 stated that prescription use ends up building emotional stress as well. This in turn only causes more problems. So in conclusion, if ever feeling unwell, just go straight to the health center or in advance, go to Rite Aid, CVS, there's many pharmacies around in San Diego, just take care of yourself. But never think that, okay, I'm still not feeling well, I'm gonna go do a bit more of taking a couple more milligrams of this or that. I have taken melatonin and I forgot that I took it. So I took NyQuil and it eventually led me to sleep for over 12 plus hours. So, for the year ahead in Cal Poly, please take care of yourselves. Thank you.